Hello all. I welcome you to the second session of the three-part webinar series of Tejas Technology Week. We discussed about fiber broadband yesterday with Dr. Sharath giving us the highlights. Those who actually missed the session can view the recording at Tejas website. Moving ahead, today we have Mr. Jishnu, Principal Architect, Technology and Standards at Tejas Networks. He will be talking about the technology and use cases in wire speed broadband with fixed LTE. There will be intermittent polls. We'll let you know. I request you all to fill your choices. And also there will be a poll at the end of the session. So I request you to give your overall experience about the entire And I would now request Jishnu to take over from here. Thank you. Jishnu, you're on mute.
Yeah. Thank you, Anu. Welcome all for the second day of the Technology Week. Let me now share the screen. Hope you can see the screen. Okay. So, I think I know you can switch off my video and I can.
Yeah, sure.
Okay. Today I would be presenting on fixed LTE, which is part of the fixed wireless access. So how I plan to cover it today is that first I'll provide you an overview of fixed wireless access or the FWA technology. The market trends which we see, the FWA use cases across various verticals, and then the third part, I would cover the Tejas FWA offering value proposition and success story. So what we see today is a rise of a new normal, whereby we see a growth, we are expecting a growth of 244% in traffic from 1.7 zettabyte to 5.7 zettabyte by 2024. Are this number an overestimate? No. Yesterday's report from Airtel shows that there is a 75% growth in data consumption just in Airtel network from the time India went for lockdown. What is driving all this? So, for example, in enterprise, remote working is becoming a popular way of working now. All of us are working remotely. There's a greater use of digital mode of interactions, and this is enabling faster migration of traffic onto cloud. So all your Zoom, Team, the Google Meet, all are moving onto the cloud. The second aspect of it is related to the telemedicine. So we can see, at least in many countries, that they have run out of beds. People are setting up what they call the COVID care centers in their apartment complex itself. And there are telemedicine packages being built around it, and people remotely help you to set up all the required infrastructure in your apartment itself. The third part is education. All the schools are shut down for most of the kids. So they are all working, learning from their home, either through live videos or through recorded videos. There is a big take of MOOC platforms. The MOOC platforms were there earlier, but now there is a huge consumption of learning through platforms. The other part is about manufacturing. Manufacturing, the industrial IoT, which was basically under discussion, is getting widely adopted. There was recently a factory which started in US, which doesn't have a single employee. All of them are working remotely. So they are using AI, VR, and AR technology in a very big way. Entertainment, all of us are doing video streaming either with Netflix or Prime videos, and so that's again creating a huge demand for data. The last but not the least is the digital economy. There is a rise in online transaction. All the social distancing norms are enabling all the e-commerce, m-commerce applications to happen. None of them are over cash now. All of them are enabled through online transfer through your mobile. So what technology to use? I think we would have covered an FTTX earlier. So one of them is to take fiber to each of the homes. So that's the most appropriate technology, which can give very high bandwidth at home. But the major issue is mostly about regulatory issues on right of way. So getting permissions from your local authorities are pretty complicated. It may be an option to do what's called the fixed wireless access, to reach the customer as fast as possible. And locking the customer is clearly important during this time so that eventually you can migrate him to FTTX. The second part is that if you don't have FTTX, what would I do as a user? I would take a mobile broadband, which would mean that I take dongle or use my phone as a hotspot. This, if you see, at least in India, is like 10x cheaper than FTTX. So typically we have an ARPU in India of around $2. And ARPU for FTTX connection in India is around $20. So there is a 10x difference between a mobile broadband and an FTTX. FWA can come in something somewhere in between. It's not as cheap as mobile broadband because we need to be offering this for a lesser number of people like mobile broadband. It will come in between FWA and FTTX, much towards MBB part of it. The third one is that MBB, though we would like to use it with dongle, even right now I was trying to use dongle, but it's very unreliable. So if you have to do something like small office, working from your home or working from home for your actual official needs, it becomes very unreliable. So we need something better than mobile broadband, as good as FTTX, but at a price point of MBB. So that's where FWA really comes in. That's the sweet spot. So are we making it up? Is this really growing? If you see the charts, it's growing at an annual pace of 16%. CAGR, mostly in North America and US, because they have also rolled out the 5G-based FWA. But what you can see in the chart below is that you can LTE as an FWA technology is going to be there till 2024, be a very cost-effective option till 5G chipset becomes cheaper. We are seeing 5G being used as a fixed wireless access option starting from this year. And we think that it will pick up further going forward. So the fixed wireless access can be offered either as LTE or 4G or can in future migrate to 5G as and when the chipset becomes cheap. So moving to the next slide, what are the other advantages of using FWA along with FTTX is that if you have a short-term customer acquisition issue, so you can basically roll out customer connectivity over FWA and then migrate him to FTTX if he requires higher capacity, higher reliability and all that. Or it can be a permanent solution for lower capacity users who are not like high paying customers. The second part of this FWA could be that if suppose you have an FTTX connection and if that end customer, whether it's an MSME or a home user, is saying that it's very unreliable, FWA can act as a backup to that FTTX and can improve the reliability of that link. So either the user would be connecting on FWA whenever there is an FTTX interruption. So this could be used like an SDN the SD-WAN type mechanism, switch between FWA and FTTX. What we have done in Tejas is that we have a single platform which delivers FWA and FTTX. The idea here that such short-term customer acquisition is possible by our end customer. Actual deployment, whether you want an FWA, FTTX, would depend on your operating capital expenditure plan, the regulatory condition. So some of the regulation requires that this should be kept separate in some countries. Other issues would be that getting the spectrum, the time to market, etc., would decide when to start FTTX and when to start FWA. Now coming to the second part of my webinar, which is about what are the typical use cases for FWA we see across various verticals. The first one we see here is if you see how do we offer an FWA is that the internet. If you have to connect to the internet, you basically connect to an EPC, which is the core element. which would eventually migrate to 5G core when 5G comes in. You have an IP backhaul or a crosshaul which connects the EPC to the base station. The base stations typically are three-sector macro. That by doing that, you can get a larger coverage. We can typically go up to even up to 10 kilometer by using an outdoor LTCPE. This CPE, you would have to put it up with a 3 meter pole if you are in 10 kilometer range, and can be directly connected on the wall of your building if it is within 5 kilometer, roughly. So that calculation would depend on the RF planning on that particular location. But roughly within 5 kilometer, you can directly put your LTCP, outdoor LTCP on the side of the wall. It need not be line of sight, but with signal, with good enough signal strength. If you are going beyond that, you can take a small 3 meter pole. And so it's like your Yagi antenna, which used to be there earlier for your TV transmission. So you can put it on that, and then you can cover up to 10 kilometers. So what are the typical verticals where we see all this getting deployed? One is obviously rural broadband. So rural doesn't make a viable case for FTTX to take it to the each household. So we see FTTX being terminated at some village headquarters and from there using FWA to reach each household. The second application is smart cities to do all the surveillance. The third one is about private LTE. We see some application where the fixed wireless access is also used to backhaul some of the 2G, 3G sites. So I'll come in detail on that. The last one is an in-building solution. I'll spend a few minutes on each of these use cases. The first one is about rural broadband. So you will have a backhaul equipment at the village office, which will have the baseband card, transmission backhaul, and an RRH, which would be connected on the top of your tower. You will have then enabled connectivity to small and medium rural businesses. They are retail shops, departmental shops in the village. The second application would be to connect the government offices to enable e-governance application. The third one could be on the public safety, where you put up a surveillance camera and it's connected to the local ANA or the police station, where they can monitor the location. So you don't need as many staff to monitor the whole. The other application is about rural development, which includes telemedicine. The hospitals may not have enough staff, so they can be supported using telemedicine from an urban center, internet banking. And the last one, and the most important one, is like provide high-speed broadband connectivity to schools, colleges, which are within that rural area. The second application is about smart cities. Here, what we see is that it's being widely being used for smart parking. So if you are parking in the wrong location, we automatically, based on the parking sticker reading mechanism, they read the sticker, check whether you violated something, and you will get the parking bills directly to your home. Similar thing on smart lighting and smart transportation, e-governance. Smart manufacturing. Smart metering is also coming up in bigger cities, whereby you can do power metering based on the peak rate. Peak rates would be higher than what you would be charged during non-peak hours. So that's another application which is coming up. Public Wi-Fi is some part which, wherever you can't do it with FTTX backhaul, you can connect it over an FWA. And the other thing is video surveillance. These are all places where I cannot connect it over FTTX. I can do an FWA. The third use case is about private LTE. So this is a niche application which has come up recently, and this is a major use case in 5G. So a lot of development around 5G development is around private 5G, private NR. We can also use LTE for a private application. So this would allow you to provide remote island connectivity where there is no way to connect fiber or any other means. You can connect it to the offshore rigs where there is no way to lay a fiber, or the satellite connectivity is not good enough. The speed required is much higher. The third application could be tactical defense, whereby you are on the move and you need to connect to that and need a gateway monitor the troop movements and all that. The last one is about enterprises, where you can monitor an IoT gateway and you can do it up to 5 to 10 kilometers. The fourth use case is about fixed backhaul. Here, 2G and 3G we presently use mostly microwave backhaul, the MWB, and that's like the point-to-multipoint option. So LTE can act like a LTE FWA can act like a P2MP backhaul, a standardized backhaul for your base stations which are on microwave today. So it's basically to handle some few E1 worth of traffic. Or if you are setting up a new greenfield 4G FWA site, another option could be that your baseband unit could be at a central place. You can run a fiber to up to 10 kilometer, 10 to 20 kilometer, and connect a radio at the appropriate tower and provide FWA connectivity to the end user. So the last use case is about in-building 4G, 5G coverage. So if you see, one of the problems which happens once you move to higher frequencies that the indoor coverage becomes bad. So you can see this straight away with 4G, which are mostly run on higher frequency bands. 2G coverages are much better. So you are able to make a 2G calls inside your house, but find it difficult to do a 4G call. So one issue is that you can have a PICO cell kept inside your home to do home coverage. But what we have seen is that in many of the high-rise apartments, the common areas, the PICOs within the home cannot cover it. So we need a better mechanism to cover it. The other option is DAS, distributed antenna system, but that is very cumbersome to manage just because there is no mechanism to centrally monitor the DAS location. So what we have been trying to do is that use the LTE FWA. Here it's like more like enabling the FWA option, but we could also handle some VoLTE calls over it. It's slightly costlier than a DAS option. So what we are thinking of and what we heard from few of the customer is that some infrastructure guy can build it up. So the building owner can build it up and they allow multiple operators to share the network. So what we do is that we have a 4x4 MIMO infrastructure, but we can split it up as two independent 2x2 MIMO, each of them being operated by two different operators. So that would allow them to share the radio and divide the cost. So that's one way of reducing the cost and then providing indoor coverage. And we need to put one radio unit for every alternate floor. So now we move to the second part of it. What does operator need to do for rolling out 4G and 5G wireless access? So we are speaking here on the FR1 band, which is in sub 6 gigahertz band. There is an option to do fixed wireless access in millimeter wave band. So that's not part of the discussion. That's mostly with 5G. So we are assuming that you will start with 4G fixed wireless access and then migrate to 5G wireless access. First thing is that all of you would need to have a licensed spectrum. In unlicensed, though there is an option to do LTE unlicensed or an NR unlicensed, point-to-point Wi-Fi is used preferably in that mode because operators want to continue to use their Wi-Fi. The problem with Wi-Fi or any unlicensed technology is that there are upper bounds on the power which you can radiate. So at least in India, the maximum you can do is 4 watt EARP, and similar restrictions are there across different countries. So with unlicensed, you can't cover a lot of distance. And then there are Fresnel zone issues which comes up. So it's preferred to use licensed spectrum where you can have much higher power to operate. The second thing is preferably pick spectrum in the 2.3 to 3.5 gigahertz band. The advantage here is that, first of all, most of the spectrum today are auctioned out. The cost of acquiring a spectrum below 2 gigahertz is extremely high, and it may not make a viable case for FWA. So the 2.3 to 3.5 has another advantage, is that all of these are potential 5G bands as well. So you can start off as 4G and then migrate to 5G. The third thing is that within this 2.3 to 3.5, you better pick TDD spectrum. The TDD spectrum is preferred because 5G is mostly about TDD. We have FDD, 5G coming up. In FWA, it's all about TDD. The advantage of having TDD is that your downlink and uplink channel estimation becomes easier because both forward and reverse direction are on the same set of bands. You can do it much easier, unlike FDD, because your frequencies are spread across. So basically, you pick up a licensed spectrum within 2.3 to 3.5 gigahertz and have TDD band. So the other thing is that I just now moved to the second part of it. Anu, do you want to do the poll now?
Yeah, Jishnu, sure. I'll just launch the poll so people can mark their choices. So the question says, which of the following LTE options are available to you for your rollouts? It's FDD LTE bands 1 to 31, TD LTE bands 38 to 42, both or not sure.
So this is related to the last slide where we are asking you if you already have acquired your FDD LTE spectrum, then that's one option. FDD option is much preferred for mobile broadband. If you have TD LTE option, which is between band 30 to 42, which is in the band which I was mentioning, about 2 gigahertz, that's the option where FWA becomes much better. But if you have both of it, then you can do carrier aggregation across TDD and FDD. You can, how long you have the poll?
We are just approaching 1 minute. Should I end it or wait for people to vote?
Maybe a few more seconds and then close.
Okay, fine. I guess we can end it now?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, everyone.
Okay, so now I move to the third part of my talk. It's basically about what Tejas has to offer in this space. What is Tejas' value proposition and our success stories which we have in from different part of the globe. So Tejas has a full end-to-end LTE broadband wireless access solution. We have an EPC which is custom built for an FWA type use scenario. This can scale up to 200,000 users. This is made with the purpose that the biggest cost for rolling out FWA is on the EPC. So we have wanted to cost reduce on the EPC part of it. So what we have done is that we have used standard servers and we have an EPC which can scale to 200,000 users. And we have a licensing option to start at a low level and then scale it up. We also have an option to scale data plane separately from control plane. So that would allow to make the core very cost effective. The core does all five aspects of it, the MME, HSS, PCRF, T-Gateway, and S-Gateway, all in one server unit. So the idea here is that should keep the cost to the very minimal. We have a transmission infrastructure. So this was covered in yesterday's talk. So we have a transport to basically backhaul all this traffic so from the core and connect it to the EPC. The E-Node B, we have two part to it. E-Node B has a baseband unit and a remote radio head, the RRH. The baseband unit is a line card which goes into our 1407 system. The same 1407, we can use it for backhaul or even for doing the FTTX connectivity. The FTTX can in turn be used for doing some small cell backhaul in 5G small cell backhaul. The remote radio head, what we have today is a 4x4 MIMO. As I mentioned, I can split it up as two independent 2x2 MIMO. I operate it in band 38, 39, 40, 41, and 42. All of them are in TDLTE with the purpose that I can migrate them to 5G as and when the handsets become viable and become widely available. And to support all of this with your planning, radio network planning, etc., we have software tools to support that. And we have an EMS to manage all this equipment. Same EMS can manage transmission, the FTTX, and the FWA. And the idea here is that once we have network slicing, we would be able to manage all this element and provide a sliced service, slicing as a service to the end customer. What does Tejas have to offer in fixed wireless access as a value proposition? The first and the foremost is like we have integrated access and transport into a single product. We call that ultra convergent. The idea here is that we can significantly reduce the operational expenditure because it's a single 2U platform where I can do FTTX, FWA, and transmission. So the space requirement is lower. Because I combined all of it, I get power saving. The other thing is that if you have to do this function with three independent product, you would need three different, roughly three times more staff to run it. We have combined all of it into a single system with a single EMS. That would reduce the manpower cost as well. The second part is that we are completely 3GPP compliant. We are completely standard based. So that means that you can pick up any CPE from the market, outdoor CPE, and we will be able to incorporate our LTE 4G, 5G solution with the third party CPE. We do offer our own CPE as part of the solution. That is in case the customer requests us to do the complete end-to-end. But we are completely 3GPP compliant and we can pick up either the EPC from some other vendor or even the CPE from some other vendor, and we can show that interoperating with any EPC or with any of the CPE. The other part is that we have done some customized scheduling mechanism, because once I know that it's a fixed user, I know that the user is not going to move around, I can estimate the channel much better, and then I can make a dynamic bandwidth provisioning, et cetera. And I can increase this bandwidth as and when based on the QoS or the SLAs he has signed up with. What we have done as part of an interaction with the customer was that we have also a customized in-building solution. As I mentioned, we use alternate floor and we can provide voltage in addition to FWA, so as to provide good coverage inside the building, especially in the common areas. If you see the application of this, is that there are many high rises where the rich guys want to stay at the topmost floor, but they just don't get any voltage coverage because most of the antennas are tilted down for street coverages and they are not expected to cover high rises. So this is where they just can provide a customized in-building solution. What we see is it's costlier than DAS, but the real advantage here is that it does provide a very good coverage inside the buildings, and it's much better than the femto solution. The other part which we have done is that if we have control on the CPE, I can also get CPEs which can support 64 QAM. You can also get high power UE, because this being outdoor and it's not being part of your handset, I don't have the issues of ICNIRP restrictions on health concerns. So I can slightly increase the power, at least 3 dB. I can also use higher QAM, so that would increase the uplink which I can do. So this is something which we have enabled through our solution. The other part which we have done is that we can, because we know which are the sites which are on cell edge and which are on the cell within the center coverage, I can do some dynamic interference cancellation mechanism that would allow users to have very less interference from the other users. So that's something which we have enabled in our solution. Coming to the solution as such, we have an RRH for the eNode B. We have a CPE, but that I have not shown here. I will show in a later slide. The RRH, I can do 10 watt per port. I can radiate 10 watt per port. We have 4x4 MIMO, I can do 4 cross 10 watt, 50 watt. In roadmap, I have planned to further scale it up, the power, all the way to 40 watt. So that you can do a lot more coverage. If you have multiple bands, I can do carrier aggregation across all these bands to give you a much larger capacity. We have a CPRI connectivity, which is a common public radio interface connectivity from the RRH to the baseband unit. The baseband unit itself, it can be at the bottom of the tower, or it can be some 5 to 10 kilometer away from the tower. Like theoretically, it can be 20 kilometer, but typically what we see is 3 to 10 kilometer from the baseband unit. If you have a fiber connectivity between the RRH and the baseband unit. The baseband unit talks to the RRS through the CPRI interface or the CIPRI interface. We are release 10 compliant. We have also added few features from other releases like 64 POM, I think, not in release 10. So we have added few additional features from the other releases. And we plan to migrate to release 15 in future. So as to make it 5G compliant. So we have a configurable bandwidth option. We can support 5, 10, and 20. We have also done 15 for a particular customer. We can also support 15 if it is required by the customer. So in the 1407 platform, we can put 5 cards, each of them handling 3 sectors. So we can have 5 locations being handled from a single baseband location. We have integrated transport, and we have also have the FTTX. So as I mentioned, we can do convergence across wireless and fixed broadband. We have an EPC. We can provide that as part of the solution if you need it, or we can talk to your standard EPC, MBB EPC. That's what as a customer you require. If you are using our EPC, we can go up to 200,000 subscriber. We can do IPv4 and V6. We also have integrated that EPC into our AMS, and it's completely redundant. You can do 1:1 redundancy for the data plane and control plane. Coming to the eNodeB platform, the eNodeB platform is a 1400 ultra-converged broadband platform. Here we can take GPON card. We can take 8-port 2.5 GPON. We are in future planning to support NGPON version of it as well. We have a CEF controller, which takes care of all the transmission requirement, all the transport requirements. We can also support OTN transport if you need, if you don't want to do packet-based transport. We have a radio access controller card. So this is the card which goes into that platform and becomes the baseband unit for the fixed wireless access or the LTE access. And this connects over a CIPRI link to a RRH. So it's a fiber connectivity, which I'm showing. And that RRH can be from in band 32, 38, 39, 40, 41, and 42. It can do 4x4 MIMO. And as I mentioned, we can do 4 cross 10 watt. And in future, I can scale it up further. The power level, I can take it up further. So we are a complete macro TDE LTE. We can scale up to 500 users per sector. So this is not like small cell, which usually do 128 users. Here I can do 500 users per sector. So from a complete 3-sector perspective, I can go up to 1,500 users. Each sector, what we have measured is around 60 Mbps downlink consistently, not the peak. So peak in the sense, consistent in the sense, it's measured in the field. It's not like a lab tested number, 60 Mbps. So with 3-sector, you can do 16 to 3, 180 Mbps, which can be shared across all the users which you have. On the terminals, we do provide it as part of a solution if customer insists. Otherwise, we can also take any third-party MiFi routers or your desktop-type router or an ODU. If you are taking our ODU, we have also customized CPE management solution, so which allows us to create some test suite right directly from the CPE. So we take standard CPEs and add some additional software modules to it. So you can see one of the aspect of it is that if you have a dongle or a MiFi router, your coverage, the antenna gains are 0 dBi, and it goes up to 7 to 10 dBi with an outdoor CPE. So that's how I can improve the coverage. And then because it's outdoor, I don't get that 1 to 3 dB loss, which typically happens as I cross a wall. So that's how I am able to cover much larger distance, 5 to 10 kilometer, with an outdoor CPE. So if you have dongle, yeah, it will be a few hundreds of meter coverage. We have a versatile EMS, NMS, and an SDN. So we can, the EMS for wireless gets interconnected to an NMS, and the NMS allows us to provision all services, whether it's enterprise, L3 VPN, L2 VPN services or transmission services, be it on PTN, OTN, DWDM, or whatever, or FTTX service on GPON, or FWA service on the wireless. And we can in future support even the 5G services on the same NMS platform. So that's the clear advantage which we have. And the plan here is that we can do this multi-layer support and then eventually by support SDN. We have already started supporting SDN for MPLS-DP and we plan to support it for other technology as well. This would enable us to create slices for EMBB services, URLLC services later when we move beyond just one application called FW. And we have to support multiple customers. We can create slices for each of these customers. So for example, if you have a BMW as one of your customer and he wants to create a pan-nation network, which he wants to use it for only his customer, that would be possible because we do multi-layer optimization. We can also do multiple failure survivability. As I mentioned, I can support between FWA and FTTX, FWA and FTTX. So that would allow us to build up a much reliable network. And we have standard northbound interfaces. We have connected to multiple different third-party OSs. We use TMF 814 and we are supporting NetConf Yang directly on the node. And we will be supporting RESTful APIs as well from the as an NBA from the NM. So coming to the roadmap part of it. So we have the EPC. So we continue to think that the migration to 5G core would take much longer time. So we are thinking that the option 3 or the NSA option would be popular at least for few years from now. And the other part is also that the 5G handsets which are available in the market are mostly NSA today, so whatever is put out. SA phones are coming up later. And the FWA based on SA would be much longer time. So what we will be doing is that we'll have a 1500 platform with an RAC supporting 4G initially. The 3GPP release 10 as the baseline release. We'll be connecting it using CPRI, the common public radio interface, either 3 or 5, which is 4.9 Gbps or 9.8 Gbps, and connect it to a base station, RRH, which would be TD-LTE. It would be in band 38, 39, 40, 41, and could be 42, but 42 is also becoming the 5G band. So 42, we think, most likely would become 5G before becoming an LTE band. We are also having a roadmap to support FD-LTE because one of our larger customers want it. So this would be for FD-LTE, we would be mostly in mobile broadband. So we'll be able to support VoLTE, mobility, and all that. So the idea here is that FD-LTE would support mobile customer, TD-LTE would support fixed wireless. We would be able to add an additional card called the 5G AC card, which would be 3GPP release 15 compliant. We need an additional card to handle much larger throughput, which we need, which we expect with 5G. So bare minimum bandwidth allocation, which is supposed to happen, is 40 megahertz. And depending on the geography, maybe higher for 5G. So we will use an additional card, which will be connected to the NR radios, which are either in N77 or N78, which is what is looking as the most potential likely band. The band 41 is also being considered as a 5G band. The first handsets are expected to be coming with N77, N78, and N41. So all of this would be supported as in our initial release to support 5G. We would be, as I mentioned, using option 33A. Initially, and we will wait and see how the standalone mode evolves. So right now it will be an NSA option, and as I mentioned, all of these are on the FD-LTE higher power radios and the 5G. Coming to major success stories, I'll three of them. So the first one is about a Southeast Asian carrier. So this was supported by the regulator, a quasi regulator who wanted to basically provide broadband connectivity solution to some remote areas. And one of the initial test case for us was an island which had no other connectivity, and we had to connect a school there. There was no option to do FTTX, etc. So we had to provide fixed wireless access to that island. We were asked to do it on band 39, which we didn't support at that time. So we did it for band 39, and we were specifically asked to do it in 15 megahertz. All of this, we were able to provide it and provide connectivity to that island. And that was like one of our largest in that region. The second case study is a PTT, a wholesale operator in Africa. Here we had to do the end-to-end thing. We had to provide EPC, the E-node Bs, the CPE, the outdoor CPEs as a turnkey project. We also had to train the staff. So we had a training program module created, and you can see we also created some certificate courses where people certified as a LTE FWA engineers, and we built it up and we have rolled it out in Africa as well. The third use case is about a Malaysian wireless ISP. So the wireless ISP initially was using WiMAX as a technology. So their existing WiMAX vendor had basically discontinued support of their product, and they wanted to migrate to an upgrade technology. So we enabled them to migrate from WiMAX to LTE. So one of the challenges which we had at that time was that they didn't want to shut down WiMAX all at once and then migrate into LTE. They wanted to do it site by site. So we did it, we shut down a particular site. The problem with doing a site by site upgrade in wireless is that you will have interference coming from the adjoining WiMAX stations. We had to do some tweaks. We had to change some pilots here and there to ensure that it worked. So we have customized it and ensured that LTE seamlessly worked with WiMAX, and this network has been operational for last close to 2 years, and we have no issue of interference from WiMAX. And so let me conclude now. So the key takeaway is, yeah, COVID-19 is both an opportunity and like threat for few of us. And how do we ensure that we can provide connectivity to a lot more homes, small offices, and critical institutions? Here, we are not using it for entertainment. We are using it to run our basic small offices. We need to provide a reliable high-speed connectivity, and we believe that FWA has that option to. It's a preferred broadband access. There is a kube provisioning, and it doesn't have issues of fiber laying, etc. So it can also supplement the dedicated fiber-based connection and provide improve the reliability of those fiber FTTX connectivity, especially if you don't have type B, type C redundancy in FTTX. It can be a cheaper option to provide redundancy for FTTX. The FWA technology can be deployed across various verticals. We saw 5 of them being discussed, be it rural broadband, smart cities, or building up a private LTE network, either for mines or oil rigs or something, or even for high-paying customers. It can also backhaul in some cases the 2G, 3G traffic, and it can provide an in-building solution, much more higher, better coverage than what you can offer with DAS or other. So I want to end by saying that we have a comprehensive world-class portfolio providing end-to-end FWA products, and it has been deployed around the globe for now 2 years. And I'm happy to take questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Jushnu. That was really informative. So before I move ahead to the Q&A part, I'll just launch the poll, and we'll want the audience to mark their choices and let us know their overall experience. Yeah. So meanwhile, I'll just start off with the questions. So we have our questions, and the first one goes is, I am a WiMAX operator. Can I migrate my network to 4G, 5G, FWA?
Yeah, as I mentioned in the third case study, so we have done such a similar case. So there is an operator who was a WiMAX operator and he wanted to migrate to LTE. So that's possible. There is some tweaks which you would have to do if you have to do site-by-site upgrade. We have done that successfully and this is very much possible.
And the next one is, can Tejas products be upgraded to 5G FWA in the future, or will that be a different product?
As I mentioned in the earlier slide, so we can use the same platform. We need an additional part to basically support 5G AC because you need to handle much larger throughput in 5G. So we can use the same platform. You have an additional blade to support 5G, higher 5G throughput. And you would have to change the RRH if it is in some other band, which is not the band you have deployed initially 4G with. So for example, if you are doing it with N77 and you have deployed with band 41 LTE, you'll have to buy an additional RRH, which runs in N77. So yes, it's possible to do 5G with the same platform.
Okay. So we have a next question from one of our attendees. Can you explain what is CPRI?
So CPRI is an optical technology. It's called Common Public Radio Interface. So this is a connectivity which is popularly used between LTE baseband unit and the RRH. It's standardized by an CPRI alliance. It's not like a standardization body. It's a group which basically has published a standard and people have been using this. So this would migrate in future to ECPRI. I think it will be covered in few of the later, right? So when we move to 5G, it will become evolved CPRI. So CPRI is Common Public Radio.
Okay. So moving on to our next question. It says, so just by fixing an LTE router at window, can we say it as fixed LTE?
So if you have a fixed LTE and you have placed it outside an outdoor CPE and connect to the mobile MBB thing, you may get a coverage. If it is within the coverage, it becomes fixed LTE. But then the issue here is that they may not be doing the QoS, which we have built up. So you may not get the throughput, reliable connectivity, which you would have. So the mobile user is not expected to do it. You will get some throughput, but it's not, you will not be able to meet the SLAs of the end customer. So it's not like, it still is mobile broadband because you are not getting any additional QoS, except that because you are a fixed user, you are not moving around your LTE device. Your CS, the channel state information may be better. So your quality of signal may be better than what you get with mobile broadband, but it will not be exactly like an FWA, which we are offering because we are also using that, the feedback to improve the QoS.
Okay. So moving ahead to our next question, can private LTE networks be deployed in industrial environments?
Yes, we can very well deploy LTE in industrial environment, especially we have seen few of these requirements coming from mines and oil rigs. They are remote. The only problem which we see is that there should be some operator who has a spectrum, because without spectrum, we can't do the 4G or 5G. So any mine operator or any private vendor who has access to spectrum either directly or through one of their service provider partner, we can build up a private LTE for them and ensure that none of their data ever goes out of their network unless it's going to public internet. So you can contain the whole communication within that area, and this can enable broadband connectivity to the user, which is, I think, becoming a mandatory thing to basically even an essential item. Right?
Okay. So we have one more question. I'm currently in the planning stages of launching an ISP business in my region. I'm open to both options, FTTX and FWA. Which approach do you advise, or can I do both?
You can do both if you have all the license regulation and regulatory. There is no regulatory constraints to doing that. For FWA, you need spectrum, and for FTTX, you need all the right-of-way permissions. Once you have both of it, yes, you can offer both FWA and FTTX simultaneously from, at least in our case, from the same equipment.
Okay. I think we'll have to close.
I see a question here, I think, on the question. There's 5G.
Okay.
Can you compare 5G with Wi-Fi? Will it be competitive with respect to each other? Okay, so coming to this, so first the difference is Wi-Fi 6 is an unlicensed band. So you can use 5 gigahertz unlicensed band for doing the fixed type application. But being unlicensed, the issue here is that you basically need a line of sight. In 5G, you don't need a line of sight. It just needs to be near line of sight. The second part of Wi-Fi 6 is, Wi-Fi 6 is also an access technology. So that's what you would be using at your home. So what would happen is, over time, this we have seen with one operator in India, when he started off doing Wi-Fi based fixed wireless access, it was initially fine. But as user density went up higher, who started using Wi-Fi, he basically couldn't sustain his business. So unlicensed band is not a great idea to do fixed wireless. So you should basically pick up a license plan and do it. If you have unlicensed, we can always enable more throughput by doing carrier aggregation across licensed and unlicensed. But that's one big difference. The Wi-Fi 6, from a pure technology perspective, both of them use OFDMA. So technology-wise, both are same. And what has happened with Wi-Fi 6 is that they have also moved on the uplink side to something like very similar to what we are doing in 5G or 4G. So uplink has improved, but then their subcarrier spacing is still higher than what is there in 5G. So 5G can have 15 kilohertz or even lower subcarrier spacing. The subcarrier spacing in Wi-Fi is 71 kilohertz, so which basically means that the granularity at which you can offer it to the end customer is different. And so if suppose within that 75 hertz is carrier spacing in Wi-Fi 6, I can roughly have three subcarrier of 5G within that. What may happen is, if only one subcarrier of 5G is not good enough, I can use the remaining two subcarriers. If I was using it as Wi-Fi, I cannot use the whole resource block because it runs with 71 kilohertz subcarrier. So there is use cases, especially we will see Wi-Fi 6 being used for point-to-point application, but I don't think there will be a huge pickup for point-to-multipoint application unless you start tweaking it. So we see some of the vendors taking Wi-Fi 6 and more or less modifying it and making it proprietary to get it working as a point-to-multipoint.
Okay. So we are done with the questions, actually, Jishnu. We don't have any more questions right now. So if anyone has any query, they can definitely write to marketing@tejasnetworks.com, and we'll be forwarding the questions to the concerned person. Thank you, everyone, for joining us for the session. We come to the end of the second webinar of the Technology Week series. And tomorrow, we are going to have our third and final one, which is Beyond Broadband, Premium Connectivity Services for Enterprises. I request you all to join us for that session. And in case you have already registered, you will definitely receive your joining link. And in case you haven't, you can go to Tejas website and register from there. Thank you once again, everyone. Thank you, Jishnu. That was a very informative session for all of us.
And we look forward. Thank you, Anu, for organizing it. Thank you, all of you, for attending it. And hope you attend the next session tomorrow as well.
Thank you.
Thank you.